إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. We start first and foremost by praising the King, the Master, the Sustainer, the Creator of the seven heavens and the earth. And we send peace and blessings upon His beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, our beloved teacher. Our beloved teacher sallallahu alayhi wasallam. My brothers, I remind myself and I remind you all to have fear of Allah azza wa jal, the fear that's most deserving. My brothers, we are in a continuous struggle to measure and to know, where do I stand? You know, many of us, we like to compete, and competition is a good quality. But there's something that I wanted to highlight here today. Where is my iman, and where is my fikr and my concern in comparison to the fikr and the concern of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his companions? My brothers, I want to share something with you today, and Malish, you know, like I always say, I want your hearts, I want your mind, and I want your imagination, you know. My brothers, we know as a believer, as a muwahid, we know that death is haqq. Death is truth. Not just any haqq, haqq al-yaqeen. Allah Azza wa Jalla says it's the ultimate truth. And we know that Jannah is haqq. And we know that hellfire is haqq. It's truth. My brothers, hellfire is not a joke. It's not a game. Many of us, we fall into the era of thinking, and hellfire, ma'anash, yani, it's a little bit of struggle. Yani, shwayat barbecue, you know, you might, you know, shwayat shawi. But yani, akhiran, no, yani, look at the end of it, I'm going to get out. We've downplayed hellfire like it's a joke. And sometimes, ma'anash, forgive me, my humble opinion, we speak about the rahmi of Allah so much that we tend to think that his punishment and his azab is, Allah Ghafur Rahim, ma'anash, yalla, no. Wrap up the conversation with what? Allah's Ghafur Rahim, no, yalla, ma'anash, pack it up. Allah, my brothers, this is not the case, man. Allah is shadeed al-iqa, Allah is severe in his punishment. And my brothers, Allah Azza wa Jal says, I will forgive any sin. I will forgive any sin. Except for the one who dies on kufr. The one who dies, my brothers, associating partners with Allah, believing in something other than Allah. For this person, there is no return. And yes, Allah forgave the prostitute from Bani Israel who fed the animal or gave the animal some drink and water. Allah Azza wa Jalla forgave her and made her from the people of Jannah. Yes, Allah can do whatever He wants. But Allah has made it clear, He's made it law, that anyone who dies on kufr, anyone who dies on anything other than the tawheed, this person is destined for hellfire for eternity. Eternity. What is hellfire, man? You know, I gave the example, Allahu A'lam, if I gave you here, if I did, ma'alash, to remind the benefits of the believer. I want you to imagine, anyone here, yeah? You came home. Ma'alash, I'm going to be a little bit explicit, but just to hit the heart, you know. I want you to imagine one of the boys here, you come home. And you've left your wife and your daughters there at home, and you went to do something. You come home, and it's late hour in the night, and you realize that the door was broken, and you walk inside, only for you to find that your wife and your daughters were raped, then brutally murdered. And yani, khalas, there's nothing more that I can really say. Your little daughter was mutilated and raped, and your wife and this person just went to town. Now I want you to imagine
that as you're trying to soak up whatever just happened in your house, you walk into the next room only to find the man that did it all is still in the room. And this person is a little mabitla da'urba fangani, he's about this high off the floor. So you already know I can physically put it on him. It's not like, well, I look, you know what, I'm angry and I want to do something, but I'm afraid maybe he's going to harm me. No, you already know that this guy, I can now grab him and do whatever I want, and there's nothing he can do. And to add to the film, let's just say the law is on your side and you have full power and full authority to do whatever you please to this person. Honestly, can anyone possibly tell me what he would do? Wallahi, no matter what picture you can paint of punishment that you're going to do to this man, it is nothing compared to what Allah has prepared in hellfire. Nothing. It's a trivial example. It's so ridiculous, it cannot be compared. This is a place that Ar-Rahman, who we all, mashallah, Allah is Ghafoor Rahim, and yes, He is, of course, Allah designed specifically to do nothing but torture human beings until there is no time, just period. Khalas. Designed for punishment. And He, Azza wa Jal, He's perfect. Allah is perfect. You see, whatever you're going to do to this guy that raped or killed or harmed or whatever he did, no matter what you're going to imagine, you by default are not perfect. So whatever plan you were going to come up with, there's imperfections in it. But Allah is perfect by nature, perfect by design, perfect in whatever He does. So now imagine what hellfire is going to be like. And my brothers, this is shocking news to some. Muslims and non-Muslims will enter Jahannam. Muslims and non-Muslims will enter. And when the non-Muslims, they see the Muslims in Jahannam, a conversation takes place between the two parties. What do the non-Muslims say to the Muslims? More or less, they say, it looks like your word, it looks like your kalima of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah has done you nothing. We ended up in the same place together. But little do they know, my brothers, that this Muslim, while he might be in there for millions of years, there will come a day when Allah Azza wa Jal will order him to come out. And this non-Muslim, my brothers, he will stay therein forever. My brothers, hellfire is not a joke. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and through the ahadith and through Quran, when hellfire will be brought forward on the day of judgment, imagine prophets, messengers, angels, everything will fall to its knees when they see hellfire. Now imagine, my brothers, that this non-Muslim that walks around us every day, if he dies in the condition that he's in, that's where he's going for eternity. This non-Muslim, my brothers, that is out there, that's living his day-to-day life, he has no idea what's coming his way if he dies in the state that he's in. And one day with Allah is equivalent to 1,000 years of our time. So the non-Muslims, when they're in there, Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal is painting the picture. When the non-Muslims are in there, and they're burning, and they're being tortured, and khalas, they cannot bear it anymore. They start calling upon the angel that was created to save, keep Jahannam, Malik, the angel Malik, who by design Allah Azza wa Jal created Malik in such a way, he cannot smile even if he wanted to. So they start calling upon Malik. Khalas. First we were with the Muslims, now the Muslims have left, we've been in here, we're being tortured, we're fried, our skin is being replaced again and again, they're thirsty, the only thing to drink is lava, when they drink, that he makes them more thirsty, so they try not to drink, but they're that thirsty, then they have. Allah, ghadab, ghadab, it's just ghadab, there's nothing more to say. So now these non-Muslims, they're there and they're thinking, bro, this has got to stop. So they start calling upon Malik. And they say, Ya Malik, Ya Malik, Ya Malik, for 1,000 years. Imagine, for 1,000 years they're calling Malik, Ya Malik, please, please, tell Allah to just stop for a minute, for a moment. Bro, let us get a breather, just for a minute. Then they say, Ya Malik, we don't want Jannah. Just let Allah destroy us. Let us become nothing. We don't want nothing. Ya Malik, for 1,000 years. And then Malik looks at them and says, he forever, and he turns his face away from them. Then, when they realize, bro, there's no chance with Malik, and there's no chance with the angels, the screws that are protecting the halas, there's none. So who do they start calling upon? They call upon Allah. This is the Ghafoor Rahim that everyone has, that we've extremely abused the concept. So they start calling upon Allah and say, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Allahu A'lam for how long? And then Allah finally answers them. And He says to them, Quran, more or less what it's translated to be. He says, stay therein humiliated forever. And the doors of Jahannam are closed. No one is to ever leave again. No sound comes in. No sound goes out. And they will stay there, my brothers, for eternity. For eternity. You know, my brothers, this is what kept Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam up all night. This is what made Muhammad have grey hairs. This is what gave your Prophet stress and concern. This is what made Rasulullah give the ultimate sacrifice, because he was forever in continuous fikr. How can I save humanity from a raging hellfire? My brothers, I'm not here to tell you, Wallah, let's go make love with non-Muslims and hold hands and sing Kumbaya, la 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 ila. But I'm telling you, these people, if they die in the state that they're in, have they any idea where they're going? Have they any idea? You and I know, but Wallahi, they don't know. They don't know. So I'm asking, where are the Muslims to have the concern and the worry that their Prophet had for these people, man? Where? Today, my brothers, unfortunately, we've developed such a satanic concept and ideology that they're kuffar, they're dogs, they're abdays, la'atullah alayhum jami'an, and may Allah disgrace them and curse them and destroy them. Allahu Akbar, where did this come from, man? Where did this come from? Your Prophet was not like this. Rasulullah had rahmah for his enemy. Wallahi, he had rahmah. Why? Because he knew they don't know. Wallahi, they don't know. But he knew sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he was continuously in harik. He was continuously in pain, thinking, how can I save humanity from hellfire? This is the job of every Muslim. Today we've developed the us and them, la wallahi la. You were sent as a rahmah to humanity, my brothers. We were sent to save mankind from hellfire. Today we've learned to hate. We've learned to hate before we've learned to love. We've learned to fight. We've learned to raise our hand before we've learned to open our arms and embrace. This was not the quality of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah had mercy even for his enemy. And let me just make something clear. I'm not saying let's become these, you know, Allahu Akbar, yani we just hug trees and love people. No, no, yes, there's right and wrong, and yes, there is jihad in Islam, and yes, there is haq and batil, and yes, the Muslim will stand on that, which, yes, I'm not denying any of these. But deep down in a believer, his rahmah and his mercy for humanity should far, yani overlap his wrath and his anger towards them, far, far. Yes, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, I'm the prophet of mercy and I'm the prophet of war. But what did he say first? He said, I'm the prophet of mercy. When he spoke to Quraysh, he says, look, I've come to save you from hellfire. I've come to save you. And then when things wouldn't work, yes, he says to them, jitikum bidab. He says, oh Quraysh, I've come to you with slaughter. But not for his sake, la wallahi la. Your prophet, my brothers, had so much rahmah. Imagine, speak to anyone today here now, tell him, brother, if you can get your hand on one of these Jews or one of these, whatever it is, yeah, and get, wallah, la afrimu, shilu, haqqu, khazza, watla, amar. Oh, Rasulullah was not like this. He would send letters. He would ask the people to embrace Islam. He would tell them, keep your leaders. Just have Islam rule the land so Rahmah can enter. And only when everything failed, only then, he says to his army, raise the flags, prepare the men, we're going in. Not to kill, la Allah, but to save them from something they don't know about. He will tell his men, when you enter a land, do not harm the children. Do not fight the elder. Do not touch their women. Do not harm their trees. Do not harm their cattle and their livestock. You enter with rahmah, even when you fight. He says, your prisoners of war, they eat from what you eat. They sleep where you sleep. Why? Rahmah. Because he had a care for them and concern for them. So much so, my brothers. Malish, again, I want you to live with me these moments, you know. In the authentic hadith, my brothers, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was sitting with Sahaba. There was a lesson, some sort of a gathering. Da'wah was taking place. I want you to leave this, you know, because sometimes when you speak about da'wah, people think, oh, da'wah is, you know, look, if I'm free, when I get the chance, or, really, I want you to leave this moment. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's sitting with Sahaba. An authentic hadith. And a young man who was sent by the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so she sends a messenger to him and he says, O Prophet of Allah, listen to this, huh? O Prophet of Allah, your daughter is asking for you, her baby son is dying. Let's leave the moment here, yeah? She says, O Prophet of Allah, which is her dad, Dad, please, my son, who's your grandson, is dying, and please, I want you to come here. So what did the Prophet of Allah do? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine, he's sitting with Sahaba, not non-Muslims, not people who, wallah, you know what, if he leaves them now, there's a chance that they're going. No, no, they were already Muslims. They were already people who were guaranteed Jannah. But because there was da'wah taking place, he says to the messenger, he says, go back to my daughter and tell her. Should I tell her? Tell her what, bro? He says, tell her, to Allah is what he gives, and to Allah is what he takes, and he, subhanahu wa ta'ala, does whatever he pleases. Tell my daughter to be patient and wait for the reward from Allah. What? Are you serious? A Prophet of Allah, this is your daughter. Your grandson is dying. And you're telling her to be patient? I want you to imagine here now, someone now walked in and said to me, Hopeless, your wife has just had a car accident, she's dying, she's here, she's just in front of Subway here. Please, she wants you to come. Lakahi, please tell her, to Allah is what he gives, to Allah is what he takes. Tell her to be patient and Allah will give her a reward. Lawallah, everyone in this room, be buzzy alayhi, look at this IOM, bro. Are you serious? The Prophet of his daughter, his own grandkid, he says, go and tell her to be what? to be patient. So the young man goes to his daughter. He says, this is what your father says. She goes, go back to him and tell him I'm making a qasam by Allah that he has to come. So he comes back, he says, a prophet of Allah, she's made a qasam that you have to go to her, man. So now sahaba are there, and the ulama comment, they say it was only because she made a qasam, and it's sunnah, that when someone makes a qasam, when someone takes an oath, you should fulfill his oath. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khalas, she's made a qasam, you know, and the boys were there, and they said, oh, Prophet of Allah, yani malash, let's go. So he picks himself up, he goes to his daughter, he grabs his grandkid, last breath. Grabs his grandson, last breath. He looks at him, he starts to cry, and he dies in his hands. Now I want you to compare this scenario to when he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was sitting with Sahaba, also having a dars. And a man comes to him, he says, a prophet of Allah, there is a Jewish boy. What is he? A Jew. There is a Jewish boy, Ya Rasulullah, he's on his deathbed, he's having his last moments. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he left the men, he left his da'wah and ran to the house. Allahu Akbar. Your grandkid, you said to Allah is what he gives and to Allah is what he takes, and tell her to be patient and real. And now a Jew who means nothing to you, who if anything his father and their tribe, they're fighting you. You left and you ran. He ran to his bedside. He comes to the young boy and begs him. He says, say la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. So the young Jew looks at his father, and his father looks around, realizes he's alone. He says, obey Abu Qasim. Say whatever Muhammad wants you to say. So the young boy says the shahada, and then dies, and then Rasulullah smiles and he says, I have saved someone from hellfire. This was the da'wah of your prophet. This was the rahmah of your prophet. This is what drove Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where is this today, my brothers? Allah azza wa jalla, he says, you are the best nation. You are the best nation sent out. Ukhrijat linnas. You were sent out to humanity. Why? Because you enjoy that which is good. Ta'maruna bilma. You enjoy that which is good. You forbid that which is evil. What? Yani you're there. You're pumping da'wah. You're calling people to Allah. You're calling people to tawheed. You're saving humanity from hellfire. You're the best nation that was sent where? Out. Not in. Today, my brothers, wallahi, and let me speak the truth. It's all about me and what makes me happy. Everyone is living what? The Aussie dream. What's the Aussie dream? Sorry, the Aussie Muslim dream. What's the Aussie Muslim dream? Well, I have a house, I own a house. Not in Ribaha. I got the money halal and I bought a house. And heck, yani, I'm the mara heck, she's beautiful, but jannin. Heck, I'm a pupa, but you can be a little bit of a she's right. A beautiful wife with about 5-6 kids, but her figure hasn't changed. She's still exactly how I first married her. And heck, yani, BMW X5, maybe Q7, yeah. S-line, not, you know what I mean? Thank you, rolling on 22s and parked in the driveway. And yani, year on, year off, I take my family to Amra. Isn't that a juicy life, cuz, really, isn't it? Yeah? And heck, you know, wherever I can, a Malaysia trip here and there. This, if I can do that and pray my 5 prayers, go to Jum'ah, and I have a hectic job that pays me big money, cuz that's the life, bro. من فتح عشاننا من طلع يلا عمره ما يكون bro. والله deep down, this is the dream. This is what every one of us is chasing. But your prophet and his men, والله they gave up all of that to think, how can we save humanity from hellfire? How? 120,000 companions were present there on Khutbat al-Wada' in Arafat. 120,000. Only 10,000 were buried in Mecca and Medina. I ask you by Allah, where are the other 110? Where? Fishing with the boys? Buying two-story houses with Porsche Cayennes? Wallahi, help me understand. Where did they go? They're living in Medina. They're living in Mecca, the greatest place in the world, where each prayer is 100,000 and the other is 1,000. They left all this and they set out to the world. How can we save humanity from hellfire?
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونصلي على الحبيب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. Sometimes, you know, I talk to the boys, I tell them about da'wah to non-Muslims. Because Allah is like, please, I know these da'wah to non-Muslims, ما ترك عبيعني, bro. They're all kuffar, they hate us and we hate them. And you know what, I can't wait to see what Allah is going to do with them on the Day of Judgment. طيب, معلش. I don't agree, but see, I don't معلش. I don't want to do da'wah to non-Muslims. طيب, حلوة. What about these Muslims that are surrounding us here, my brothers? What about the thousands and thousands of Muslims in our community here? Wallahi bihlif billah, I would make an oath by Allah that everyone in this room knows at least 5 Muslims that don't pray. Am I wrong? Please, yani really help me. Is there anyone here who doesn't know at least 1 Muslim that doesn't pray? Brother, I ask you, if this brother dies in that condition and he doesn't pray, where's he going there, Dayani? Where's he going? Halalulu? Where? Is he going to Bali? The man died without salah in his life. This year alone, this year, not 2014, I myself have buried eight brothers alone, all of which were under the age of 25. Not one of them prayed. Every one of them was clean shaven. One of them died while committing zina, not after, not before. He was that high on ecstasy. Astaghfirullah, but there's kids. Wallahi, there's kids, and I'm gonna respect the gathering. He died in zina. What about the one that was strapped to go hit up his un-Muslim brother, but he got done before he got there? Yani, please, yani, I don't know, maybe I'm an extremist, but I don't know, wallahi, maybe I'm with the fairies. But this young brother, what's his condition before Allah? Today, my brothers, because the ghadab has become so bad, we've taken it lightly. I know, Allah, you know what, Allah yahdi, ma bi salli, bas la, ma fi minnu, ma fi minnu. The brother comes, he's asking for the guy's daughter. Kul shi fi bi jamin. Ayni mitl ma baddak, bro. O masori mitl ma baddak, o bishtaghil, o shab tayyib, o akhlaq, o kul. Bas annu ma bi salli, bas. Ma bi salli. He doesn't pray. You know, my brothers, Malish, again, let me be a little bit explicit. I want you to imagine any one of you here caught your own sister committing zina. Huh, zina. How would you feel? How would you feel? Imagine you caught your wife, Malish, I'm really going to push buttons here today. You caught your wife doing the dirty. Wallahi, my brothers, wallahi, bahlif billah ta'ala, I make an oath by Allah. It is easier, I'm not encouraging it, it is easier for you to rape and commit zina and sell drugs and do drugs and commit murder on a daily basis. All of this put together is easier in the eyes of Allah than for you to miss one salah, one prayer. It is easier for you to kill a baby in the eyes of Allah than for you to miss one fajr. As far as sin is concerned, it's easier. Maybe Allah will forgive you for that. But to die without salah, you have no chance.
How many millions and millions of Muslims don't pray? How many of our fathers and mothers don't pray? Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, this is his opinion, so don't come to me and say, well, I look hopeless, I'll be kafir bin this. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal says, the man who leaves Salah has left the fold of Islam, no longer Muslim. So maybe, طيب أخي لك الحمد لله أنا ما حنبلي أنا من الشافعي طيب حلاوة تعال هون يا شافعي أنت تعال إمام شافعي and إمام مالك he say no he's not kafir we'll give him 3 days in jail if he doesn't pray then we'll execute him. Maybe someone here especially if it's Pakistani Indian well الحمد لله أنا حنفي bro. Hanafi says تعال come. We will not give you the satisfaction of being killed. We will imprison him and torture him until he pays or dies, whichever comes first. And thousands around us here have left Salah like it's... And Jen Shai, bro, don't worry about it, man. Who's, honestly, my brothers, who is responsible for these people, man? And I look at the brothers around me, nothing. No fire in their heart, no concern. Because I don't know how to do da'wah, man. I don't know what to say. Brothers, honestly, if a dog, an animal, came into this majlis, now, as we're sitting, a dog walked into this majlis now, and the dog was on fire. Does anyone in this room need me to give him a khutbah as to what he needs to do to help the dog? Is there anyone in this room who thinks, oh, well, look, you know what, I'm in a bit of a situation, but I don't know what to do? But if a dog, Ya Ahmad Allah, if a dog is on fire, wallahi, not a single one of you, everyone would sacrifice his shirt, his hat, his bucket, some, help the animal, bro, it's on fire! What about the thousands and thousands of people that are on fire but they just don't know it? And if they die in that condition, خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا. I jumped on Google the other, 184,000 people die every single day around the world. 184,000 people enter Jahannam. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا. And where are the Muslims? Yalla kaz, yalla. One more. Where's my protein shake, kaz? Where's my protein shake? Thousands are dying around them. Thousands are on fire around them. Who ikhad lu'adlu protein shake? And do I take this before that? Do you eat chicken all the time or should I have tuna and not? I'm a follower of Muhammad. I'm a follower of Muhammad. My brothers, honestly, man. Really, man, where are we, man? Seriously, where are we? When Rustam, sorry, when one of the companions, he came to Rustam. Rustam was one of the leaders, I believe, of the Persian Empire. He was one of the leaders, and they were fighting the Muslims at the time during the Khilafah of who? Umar ibn al-Khattab. Let's just, because now we have this sick mentality that to give da'wah, you have to be a scholar. No, you don't have to be a scholar. Speak about Allah and this is enough. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَالَ. And who is better in speech than the one that calls to Allah Azza wa Jal? Who? What's the dua you make after someone calls the adhan? Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha. What? Allahumma rabbi hadhi da'wati tamma. Oh Allah, the Lord of this perfect call, this perfect da'wah. You know the adhan? Go to the world and share the adhan with them. Go to the world and share adhan with them. When Rustam was losing, Allah is losing the Persian Empire, losing to Muslims. This he couldn't comprehend. So he sent to the Muslims and said to them, send me one of your people. Send me a delegation. Let me see these Muslims that are conquering our land. So Sa'd bin Abi Waqas, I believe it was, who was the leader of the army at the time, he sent one of the companions, Rabi'ah, it was, who?
Rubai,
that's right. So he sends him. I want you to imagine Persian Empire, kingdom, men, gold, slavery, seal, Persian, so they're waiting for the Muslims. The Muslims, they're coming to talk to us. These men who are conquering our land, they're coming to talk. They were expecting entourage. Who rocks up? One companion on a crippled donkey doing these ones. When Rustam saying this, wallahi, he's thinking, but what? It was muskhur to the highest extent. Yani, sure, is this what they sent me? So he rocks up on a crippled donkey to meet the ruler of the Persian Empire. And he had his men and red carpet and silk cushions, umma cushions. And he rocks up on a crippled donkey and his spear. And he grabs his donkey, walks, and he's sitting on his throne. His men are around him. And in the narration, as he's walking into him, he starts stabbing the cushions with his spear. They're all looking at each other, looking at him. What's going on? He rocks up to his throne, and ties his donkey to the throne. Says, "Damn, what do you want? What did you ask for me? You're wasting my time, cuz. What do you want?" He says, "Who are you people, man? What do you want?" Listen to the words. He says, We are a people whom Allah sent. No Umar ibn Khattab. No Sa'd bin Abi. No. He says, "We are a people whom Allah sent to take humanity away from the worship of creation to the worship of the Creator. To take them away from the tightness of this world to the vastness of the hereafter. That's who we are, cuz. That's why we're here. Me and my donkey." Where are these people today, man? Where? Where's the fire in the ummah to save humanity, bro? Wallahi, your neighbor, he could be the biggest kalb in the area. He could be the biggest khanzir, hayawan, whatever you want. But brother, if he dies, he's going to Jahannam for eternity. Wallahi, this is not a joke. And I'll be like, yes, some people, you see him, you say, alright. But for how long, cuz? Me, alf sini, yakh malun sini. But there comes a point where, eternity, what do you do? What do you do? So my brothers, wallahi, every single one of you is a caller to Allah. If you don't have the courage to call on Muslims, then how about the Muslims around you? How about the thousands who don't pray? How about the Muslims who shave their beard on a daily basis? You walk like a dim limri, you be amin like a. And it's not, you know what, wallahi, with all respect, it's not Nawala, look, he's shaving his beard because he's finding a heart. No, some of them are shaving and he's convinced that this is better than that. Rasulullah refused to look at two non-Muslims. They were non-Muslims. They came to him clean shaven. He looked at them and turned his face. He says, "Where do you get such a disgusting habit from?" But they're not Muslims, cuz. Like, no. He says, "Where does this come from?" They said, "Our king has taught us to do this." He says, "My king has told me to grow my beard." Thousands are dying clean shaven. No one cares. Thousands are dying without hijab. Brother, relax. Don't worry about it. All of these bigger things to worry about. Thousands. And where is the heart? Where is the fikr? Where is the concern? Where? Now, where is it? Who will save these people, my brothers? Who? Who? You think Allah needs ubbad? Do we think that Allah needs people to Allah pray and give zakat and fast Ramadan? Are you serious? He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, أَطَّتِ السَّمَاءُ وَحُقَّ لَهَا أَنْ تَأْتِ. He's sitting with Sahaba. He says to his companions, he says, "I see what you don't and I hear what you don't." He says, "By Allah, the heavens have squeaked and they have every right to squeak." They said, "Why, Rasulullah, why are the heavens squeaking?" He says, "There isn't room for four fingers in the heavens except there is an angel in prostration to Allah Azza wa Jal." You think Allah needs my salah? Is that what you think? You think Allah needs my charity? La wallah. But Allah needs men. Allah needs men who are ready to stand up and carry on the mission of Muhammad, carry on the concern of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Not to build houses and this is all halal. Don't come to me after and say, "Kaz, is a haram to go fishing." No. But fakr and concern, my brothers, wallahi, this ummah was sent to save humanity. And every single one of us, forgive me, I'll talk too long, but every single one of us needs to have this intention. Are we all ready for this, inshallah? Wallahi, just have a burning heart. And my brothers, Malish, forgive me, ya Allah, kharbeni, bro. Really, when we give da'wah, this is my humble experience. Now I'm sharing with you personal experience. When we give da'wah to people, I don't give da'wah because I want him to pray, though that's a beautiful thing. No. When I give da'wah, my brothers, you should give da'wah with a burning heart. This person needs to believe that this person really cares. Da'wah is connecting people to Allah. Wallahi, it's not about making people pray. If I connect him to Allah, I can let him go. But if he's not connected to Allah, then he's finished. It's about connecting. So don't leave now and go to your mate who doesn't pray. ما بطلع طاقة عن الإمام أحمد كافر وعن الإمام شافعي بننزل فيك الأثناء. This is not the concern, no. But to have concern, my brother, wallahi, if you die in this state, where will you go, man? My sister, you don't have hijab. My sister, if you die like this, where will you go? My brother, Allah is not in your life. How will you ever see happiness? But today, try to find a brother that doesn't have a taloo. Before it was one alaik fi kab wahid khirbaib al-matta. Now everyone's got it. Now find someone that doesn't have a taloo. Wallah, he's a wali of Allah. Rasulullah says, cursed. Rasulullah, who had rahmah for enemies, ya Allah, he had rahmah for enemies, is saying, may Allah curse. May Allah curse the one who gives the tattoo and takes the tattoo. Liam, hotitli his army pants, he's got his Nike dry feet hat on. On the back, he's soldier of Allah. And me and Muhammad are like this, we are cowies. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. My brothers, wallahi, it's not a joke. So forgive me again, wallahi, it's just all over the place, bro. Wallahi, da'wah, my brothers, we have to give da'wah.